Hi, everybody. Welcome back to our remote writing workshop. We have been on a little bit of a hiatus because we have just been so incredibly busy here at Greenleaf, just obviously really good things on all accounts, but we haven't had the time to film, but we're back, we're ready. And this week we're talking about permissions and releases. What do you need to know? So many writers don't even think about the importance of obtaining permissions and releases, but you must keep these legalities in mind, especially if you're writing nonfiction, and ideally before and as you're drafting your manuscript. You don't want to complete your memoir, for example, and then realize you can't publish a word of it without signed releases from everyone you mention who's identifiable. So we're going to give you a quick lesson on what you need to know about permissions and releases. And I just want to say a quick note, any submission that comes in, our attorney, lovely attorney Sujin, goes through everything and notes what we need from each author, so we will always help you out in that regard. Mm-hmm. All right, starting off strong with the basics, Erin, when and why do you need permissions and releases, and what is the difference between the two? We were just talking about this with our COO. She likes to quiz new employees on the difference between, mm-hmm. I think both Erin and I got this wrong our first time around.
Exactly. And it's so important. And a lot of people don't think about these before they start writing. And it's something you want to keep in mind. So we're going to have a lot of little details, but again, very important to know. So, and you want to seek permissions to cover any instances in your manuscript of third-party owned text and images. This is from books, magazines, online sources. And it's very important that you understand that if you've used text, images, art, screenshots, song lyrics, poems, any content elements from any other source, printed or otherwise, you must request permission for the use of those items from the copyright holder. And most materials found in printed form or on the internet are copyrighted. And in order to use them in your book, you need to request and be granted permission. So that's what we mean by getting permissions. And so if you don't do this, you're in violation of copyright law and you can be sued. We don't want that. Also, releases should be sought when you include interviews, personal information, or personal dialogue content. So that's a big one for memoirs. And as with permissions, if you don't seek a release from someone that's featured in your book, you risk being sued. We don't want legal action. So for example, if you write a memoir about your abusive ex-husband, he can absolutely come after you in court if the information was not public knowledge. At Greenleaf, as you mentioned, when we first read a manuscript submission and sign the contract with the author, or again, even beforehand in our submission discovery meetings, we make note of any permissions or release issues that might arise. But you as an author need to keep these things in mind as well as you write.
Definitely. And that's something to definitely keep in mind, especially with memoir, or especially like in business success, when you're talking about success of, let's say you're a past CEO of a company, you still need to have the release, from that company stating that you are allowed to talk about these experiences in your book. And that's where a lot of authors slip up, because especially if they're talking about, you know, sensitive material that they experienced, it's a little bit trickier to get those signed permissions and releases.
If it's not public knowledge, exactly.
Definitely. So what materials require permissions, and aren't there some fair use materials?
Yes, and many of you might be familiar with the term fair use, but a lot of people don't really understand what it means. And the term fair use does not mean that you have the right to use copyrighted materials as you see fit. And fair use does mean that minimal, commercially insignificant portions of a copyrighted work can be copied or quoted or paraphrased for purposes, and this is very important, for purposes of comment, criticism, illustration, or education. Mm-hmm. So if you're not sure if your use of certain material would be considered fair use, you should really err on the side of caution and request permission. So at what point do certain materials leave the realm of fair use? Well, a few examples of when you need permission. These are kind of rules of thumb to remember. When you use a quotation or several quotations of more than 300 words, that's kind of the magic number, from a full-length book, that's in total, you need to seek permission. So if it's less than 300 words, you can use a footnote or an endnote. Yay. So if you want to trim some things and not have to seek official permission, that's the way to do it. When you use a single quotation of more than 50 words from a newspaper, magazine, or journal article, you need to seek permission. So if it's less than 50 words, from a journal or magazine. You can use a footnote or endnote. So it's interesting. Obviously, you notice that the word count is a lot lower for newspaper, magazines, and journal articles. You also need permission when you use material that includes all or part of a poem or song lyric, even as little as one line. Authors love to throw in song lyrics, and fair use is often assessed in terms of percentages. So even if one line you quote of a song happens to be 15% of that song's lyrics, you're probably infringing on the copyright. So at Greenleaf, we always say, no song lyrics at all. We'll let you use the song title, artist, even paraphrase a few lyrics. But unless you want to, for example, pay Bob Dylan $10,000 or face him in court, don't quote lyrics in your book. You also need permission to use figures, charts, tables, any graphical representation of information. That means even if you have adapted or enhanced those tables or figures to fit your needs, it still looks like the original, you're still on the hook. You need permission to use photographs, other forms of art, any images showing representations of online information, for example, web pages, screenshots of software. And oh, you definitely need permission to use images of brand name products, logos. You can't just throw in a picture of the FedEx logo or the Coca-Cola logo. You need to contact the company to get permission. Now, what doesn't need permission, this is a shorter list, government publications. It's considered public domain, all materials published by the government. Other materials in the public domain, such as those for which the copyright has expired. Also, interviews you conduct, as long as a person knows he or she is being interviewed for publication, otherwise you'll need a release, of course. And facts, information, and ideas that are obtained from another source, but basically you paraphrase them. Mm-hmm. And it's very important to note that regardless of whether or not you need to request permission of certain material, you should always give credit to the original publication or author or copyright holder, because it not only does this include things, because you don't need to do this when you have widely known concepts and theories, but when it's actual facts and information that you're not paraphrasing or changing in any way, you really, really want to request permission because you don't want to get in legal hot water. So kind of rule of thumb.
Definitely. Wow. That is so much information to know.
I know it's a lot of little details, but
yeah, it's so important to know before you even begin writing. So basically, do not plagiarize. You learn this in college, you guys. And, you know, when our teachers, especially now, whenever I was going through school, and I know my brother's going to school, they have software now that, you know, will go over your entire, I know when I was doing my master's, we had to turn in every paper through the software that literally scanned the entire internet for plagiarism. And so you never, never, plagiarism is a big no, 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 no.
You'll get busted.
Yeah, you will. In college, you can get expelled from doing that. Like people take it very seriously. In real life, you can get sued. You can just so much, just no.
Yeah, your book will be shut down.
Oh yeah.
Not gonna happen.
And that, you know, after you've spent so much time, so much work for that to happen is just, no, just don't do it. Mm-hmm. Yep. So what about releases, Erin?
Well, this is very important, as we spoke about earlier, because a lot of people write memoirs and other nonfiction, and they don't realize that they need releases from everyone mentioned in the story, especially if the material, stories, or images that are used aren't flattering, and especially if the content isn't public knowledge, as we mentioned. And just because someone is part of your personal story doesn't mean you can share part of their story with the world without their consent. And just because they're jerks doesn't mean you don't have to get releases from them. Now, you don't need a release if the person has passed away, which I never actually realized that, but it's true, or if the information you include is, again, publicly available knowledge. To avoid getting releases, you can change someone's name and make them completely unidentifiable in all respects. So that means you have to change their position in a company. You have to change their physical attributions. You have to change their relationship, you know, in all ways. No one can figure out who this person is. No reader at all. Otherwise, get sued. And so that's why it's extremely important to think of releases before you begin writing.
Awesome. So how do you go about getting, I was actually going to ask that question. So what if you change someone's name? because we read in a lot of books, names have been changed to like preserve someone's identity or whatever. So let's say you're talking about an abusive ex-husband and people who know who this person is, but you change his name. Mm-hmm. Would that still count as?
Well, we kind of had a situation like that, or I've experienced that in the past. And instead of saying ex-husband, we change it to ex. And so, and really change identifiable.
So it could be a number of people.
Exactly. So yes, there are ways to get around it. And that's when it's helpful to have, as you mentioned, our wonderful legal counsel, and really make sure that there's enough that's changed that people can't bring a suit against you. And you can go, oh, that's not, no, I wasn't talking about him. No, not at all. Of course not. So.
And the great thing, I just want to shout out Sujin. I don't think he's on social media, so he may not see this, but big shout out to Sujin. He is our legal counsel here at Greenleaf. He goes through every single manuscript that we take to review prior to our review session, gives us his notes, goes through the entire manuscript and says, I need this. Mark this for elevated review because it is a memoir. There will be personal anecdotes. You know, elevated review just means a further review of everything that needs to go into making a memoir, being able to publish a memoir. So there, like Aaron said, there are so many different things, especially when you're talking about personal stories, personal anecdotes, permissions, releases, all of that. But he's so good at catching everything in the beginning, and then we'll guide the authors through what they need as well.
Absolutely. And as we go through the developmental edits and other stages of edits, I'm consistently highlighting sections of new material and sending them over to him saying, okay, we made this adjustment. What do you think about this? And he'll send back small edits. So yes, it's very important, all of these little details. We do it all the time.
Great. Thanks, Sujin. So how does an author go about getting permissions and releases?
I'm going to give you a lot of detail here, but it's critical for you to request permissions and releases as early as possible when you're writing, even if you're not sure you're going to use certain materials, because the permission process can take months. You have to track down these people. You have to send in forms. You have to get them back. So do it as early as possible. There's nothing worse than waiting until, you know, you're getting close to publication and go, oh my God, I have to get permissions for all of this content. When requesting permission to use certain materials, the first step, of course, is you want to identify the copyright holder. So for books, typically copyright holder is a publisher, but it's sometimes the author. For magazines and journals, the magazine's almost a copyright holder, so you can contact them directly. Articles on the web, typically the publishing website is the copyright holder, but if not, they'll tell you the author holds it and they'll be able to direct you to that author, hopefully. Once you've identified the copyright holder, you have to contact them requesting permission. A lot of the magazines, publishers, journals, and other websites have an entire department that's devoted to permission requests. So usually you can easily find out how to contact these copyright holders. And you're going to be asked to submit a letter or form with specific information. So you can't just say, casually, I'm using this. Hey, you have to provide your name of the book, how many copies are being printed, the rights you're requesting, North American rights, world rights, the languages you'll be printing in. And then you have to give specific information about the original material you're using, the authors, the title, the copyright date, publication date, page number, URL. The exact description of the material. So you'll be submitting a copy of the content as it exists in your manuscript. So be ready to provide a lot of detail. And once you've requested permission and you've received a signed copy of your letter and or form that grants the permission, you will need to, a lot of times there'll be a fee that's quoted by the copyright holder. A lot of times they'll do it gratis, which is lovely. And until you pay the permission fee, if there is one, you don't have permission to use the material. So make note of that. You want to make a copy of the letter for your records, send a copy of that letter to your publisher. So everyone has it on file, and follow the instructions provided, because usually you're going to get a credit line that you will need to include on the copyright page or below the image or wherever the copyright holder says. And really, when you follow these standard guidelines of the publishing industry regarding fair use, permissions, you're really emphasizing your credibility as an author, and you're inspiring others to request permission when using materials from your book. And, you know, of course, you're also avoiding the legal mess of a copyright infringement suit. But in all ways, it's a really good thing to really be good about seeking permissions, releases, good for you, good for everyone.
Yay. Oh my gosh, Erin, such great information. So I really needed a brush up on all these terms as well. So this is so important to note, especially as you begin writing, especially in the nonfiction space. Very, very important to note. So this was such an informative episode, Erin. So what is this week's assignment?
Well, you know, take a look at your work in progress, see if you might encounter any permission or release issues, make a list of who you will need to approach for permissions or take the appropriate measures to delete or adjust the content. And also just for fun, you know, as I was prepping for this, I was looking at some fun historical copyright infringement cases. There's a few like, let's see, Salinger, J.D. Salinger kind of sued a lot of people who have tried to write books, you know, featuring Holden Caulfield. Or there's a lot of fan fiction cases, people who have taken characters and tried to change them just enough to write their own novel afterwards. Margaret Mitchell's estate for Gone with the Wind, they like to sue everyone who tries to take the characters, and, you know, rightly so in many cases. But it's really interesting to kind of Google some of these cases, and there's a lot of colorful material you can find. So do that for fun.
Awesome. Thank you again so much for brushing up all of this information. Guys, it might be, you know, this isn't as fun to talk about, but it's so needed. It is so
very important,
especially when you're going through, because copyright infringement is never fun. And especially, you know, any sort of plagiarism will always come back to bite you. Just, you know, do it right, do it clean, and, you know, you won't have anything coming back to you, either in legal fees, in lawyer fees, or whatever. Just do everything the right way.
Yes,
awesome. Thank you, Erin, for your time. Guys, well, we have scaled back to doing these twice a month. We are just so busy at the moment, which is a great thing for Greenleaf, but we will be doing these twice a month. So as always, send in your questions, send in your topic ideas. We love to hear from you guys, and this will be available on all our social media channels. And always, as always, DM me for any personal questions or anything about Greenleaf, or to get in contact about writing a book, talking to a publisher, things like that. But we will see you guys next time.
Bye.